Welcome to Christ Way Church. Here's Pastor Anu with today's message.
Today we are going to learn about a very important subject, anger, your killer companion. Anger kills you, kills the unity in families and churches and the relationship with God Almighty as well.
So this morning I want to talk to you about the danger in our anger. Anger is one letter away from danger. If you cut D from the word danger, what you get is the word anger. We read the word of Lord Jesus Christ from Matthew 5, 21 to 26. You have heard it. It was said to those of old, you shall not murder, and whoever murders will be liable to judgment. But I say to you that everyone who is angry with his brother will be liable to judgment. Whoever insults his brother will be liable to the council. And whoever says you fool will be liable to the hell of fire. So if you are offering your gift at the altar, and there remember that your brother has something against you, leave your gift there before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and offer your gift. Come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand over to the judge and to the guard and you be put in the prison. Truly I say to you, you will never get out until you have paid the last penny. I pray that may God help us to understand the revelation that God has given me. We have to have a deliverance from this area, because the spirit of anger is the spirit of murder. All of us are carrying the spirit of murder and living at present also you are sitting with the spirit of murder. So listen to me very carefully. Lord Jesus Christ said, you have heard that it was said that to the men of the Old Testament, you shall not kill. You shall not kill is the sixth commandment of the Ten Commandments. Jesus was not only referring to the Ten Commandments, but also the interpretation that the religious leaders had of these commandments. And the problem was that the Pharisees and the scribes were teaching that only the physical act of murder is implied in the commandment. Then Lord Jesus Christ says, but I say to you, if you are angry with your brother, you have already committed a crime as bad as a murder. You are like to end up as much in hell as the person who committed a murder. If we can imagine how sinful is a person and what punishment a person who murders get, we will always tell he's a murderer. Or at the end, if he's suffering, he'll tell, see why he's suffering? Because he was a murderer. Same punishment only we all get through our anger, you should understand. So Jesus says, whoever says fool shall be liable to hell of fire. Jesus says, if you insult your brother, if you say to your brother, raka, it's an Aramaic word which means empty. So when you say to your brother, raka or fool, you are telling that person, empty-headed man, idiot, you will be liable to the council. See, you don't believe whatever is written in the Bible or whatever the preachers of the Jesus Christ say, you don't believe. But we are all carrying these characters, and if we don't deal with that, at the end of our life, we will be bedridden, or you can earn all the money and give it to the doctors. That's why the hospitals are running very well. Today, the best profession is a doctor. Doctors can earn well. Okay, so please listen to me. Don't think that every Sunday she will bring some message and she will preach and go. Understand. So today you have to understand this and deal with your spirit of anger. Lord Jesus Christ says here, if you say to your brother, you fool, we all use you fool, idiot. When anger comes, what is the first word comes from our mouth? You fool, you idiot. You don't know what consequences is going to happen through the one word, you fool and idiot. So the word fool is a stronger word than the word that is translated raka, because the Bible has a strong spiritual overnote for the word fool. Psalms 14:1, we read, the fool said in his heart, there is no God. So if we say a person you fool, you are spiritually and morally degrading that person without knowing that person. Sometimes you may tell, I'm a fool. That means I don't respect God. I do respect God. So what will happen? God will punish you. You are saying that person is a godless fellow. It is to say that he doesn't know God at all and passing a spiritual death sentence on him. You are passing a statement of condemnation that wipes him completely out of the commandment and out of the kingdom of God. You are passing a sentence on him. So you will get the reward for that. You should understand. So you should notice the underlying theme of verses 23. That is the problem of anger. A recent medical study found that those who were quick to anger, those who are short-tempered, will tell, that's okay, that is human. You wait, this is the medical report I'm giving you. A recent medical study found that those who are quick to anger, short-tempered, are undergoing stress, were 3 times more likely to develop premature heart disease, and 5 times more likely to have an early heart attack. Anytime heart disease will come to you, please understand, if you don't deal with your short temper, finally you will end up with the heart disease. Angry young men, it appears, turn to angry old men with heart diseases. So you should notice, when Lord Jesus Christ says, everyone who is angry with his brother shall be liable to judgment, does that mean that to be angry is always wrong? There is an anger that is prolonged and carried out, and they say that it is this anger that God is referring to. And there is another anger that dies quickly down, as opposed to the continued anger. But you cannot justify, you know your anger. So you cannot justify your anger and tell that it's human. Everybody get angry, that's okay. Please understand, you can go and ask the medical science, medical people also. Or read such book and understand what will happen, what will give you your anger. Only heart disease, understand. Ecclesiastes 7:9 says, don't be quick-tempered, that is being a fool. And Proverbs 19:11 says, a wise man restrains his anger and overlooks insults. Ecclesiastes 7:9 says, anger lodges in the heart of fools. So if you cannot deal with your anger, even after you are born again, your heart will be a habitation for anger, and in God's kingdom you are living as a foolish virgin. You think the strength of your anger, how much you have angry towards brothers and sisters only. So don't think that you are a wise virgin, you are a foolish virgin. Ecclesiastes 7:9. Lord Jesus Christ is speaking here an anger which relates to murder. Whether it is a cool or calculated anger, or it is an instant burst of anger, both can kill the other person. It doesn't matter what kind of anger it is. The problem is that both can give birth to murder. But there is another kind of anger, that is a righteous kind of anger, in which a person is angry because of the sin and the unrighteousness, injustice. It is often said in the Bible that the wrath of God is provoked by the sinfulness of the people. Unrighteous anger is the one which is selfish, and it is felt because of our ego has been offended. The scripture do make no distinction between righteous and unrighteous anger. To decide whether one's anger is righteous or unrighteous, you should understand the people closely. Anger towards unrighteousness without keeping anger in the heart towards the people is righteous anger. Anger is opposite to forgiveness. So the righteous person judges all things, but he himself is to be judged by no one. 1 Corinthians 2:15 says, he is a spiritually strong person. He can bear with the failings of the weak, and he will easily forgive. Romans 15:1-2. If you are a spiritual person and doing the ministry of God, so you will easily forgive the ego of the people. Not when they, you cannot forgive the unrighteousness what they, this distinction you should understand. Okay, are you getting me? But misunderstanding people will judge the spiritual people. There is a righteous anger. That anger is towards the unrighteousness of the people when they don't do the righteousness. Okay, so you cannot judge a spiritual person. He will bear the failings of the weak people, and there won't be any jealousy or strife or bitterness inside of them. 1 Corinthians 3:3 says that if there is still jealousy and strife among you, you are of flesh. Strife comes from anger. To decide whether one's anger is righteous or unrighteous, you need to have a close examination. Bible says in Ephesians 4:26, be angry and do not sin. Even if an emotion of anger comes, If you don't keep the bad account of that person in your heart, that is righteous. It is possible to be angry and do not sin. Jesus was angry when he cleaned the temple, when he drew the money changers out of the temple. You remember that incident that is recorded in John 2, 13 to 22. Here people saw Jesus' expression of anger. Jesus didn't hold that anger towards them. His anger was because of the unrighteousness of the people. That is not because of ego. That you should understand. So don't justify all your anger and say that is my anger is spiritual anger. My anger is righteous anger. You cannot justify your anger. You have to deal with your anger. You have to examine your anger. Otherwise, that will be killing you only. You are trying to kill other person. At the same time, it will kill you. You should understand. When Jesus says, in our context, whoever is angry with his brother, we understand that he is referring to a sinful kind of anger. Bible says in 1 John 3:15, whoever hates his brother is a murderer. A person who hates his brother has committed a murder already. Because see, we are all dealing with that. Don't think and no, I don't have this issue. I will immediately forgive. Not that. See, what you are carrying, you should understand. The spirit of murder, it will kill you. One day you will definitely become a heart patient because of your anger, you should understand. Many heart problems will develop in you. So hate is equal to murder. So if you are angry with your brother and you let that anger grow, it will inevitably become hatred. And Lord Jesus Christ tells us that in the eyes of God, that is sin. And even if you have not done anything in action, the heart only, outside you may look holy, but inside only the hatred is developing. Okay, please deal with that. That's the reason last Tuesday message also I told. If you find any problem with a person, go and deal with him. Don't carry the anger towards a person. It is killing you, you should understand. Because the person who is angry so as to hate his brother has the same feeling and the same spirit as of a murderer. God looks and judges by the heart, not by the behavior. You should understand. You can cheat the people by your outside appearance, but you cannot cheat God. God is watching. But people judge by the outside appearance. 1 Samuel 16:7. Matthew 5:23, Jesus says, if you are offering your gift at the altar, there remembers that your brother has something against you. Where is this altar? It is some special place or the altar is church? No. Jesus Christ is our altar. Hebrews 13:10. You have one understanding. Okay, when I bring the revelation, you people have one understanding and you will be hitting and go and open all the website and hear from you. No. Eh? No, sister is telling Jesus Christ is the altar. This revelation you might have not seen from anywhere. So you think altar is church. Only in the church you have to deal with your anger. I will explain to you. So which is this altar? Is it a special place or a church? No. It is our altar is Jesus Christ himself. Hebrews 13:10. What are the gifts that we are bringing to this altar? Our worship, our thanksgiving, our prayer and our ministry. Whatever we give it to God. So the meaning of if you are offering your gift at the altar means Matthew 11:25 and Matthew 6:5. Whenever you stand for praying, whenever you are going for ministry, whenever you are worshipping, whenever you are giving thanks, anywhere you are in the marketplace or in your office or at home, anywhere, you are before the altar of God. Okay? So whenever and anywhere we connect our heart in prayer or worship, we are coming before this altar. We must never imagine that God can accept an offering from us while we harbor. Oh, many people will go for ministry with full of anger, isn't it? So we must never imagine that God can accept an offering from us while we harbor our enmity in our heart of even the slightest despising your brother, condemning your brother will injure your soul. Despising a person through acts like murder, despising a person through the attitude like anger, they will imperil your soul. Having an anger, you are going, you should understand, you have killed somebody and you are going for ministry. Same. Okay. So, since despising a brother brings us into peril with God, it's not true that God would receive the offering of our worship, prayers, thanksgiving, even our ministry, while we contemn our brother in our heart. How much you are angry at me? You tell me. You should check in you. All these days, what prayers, worship, thanksgiving, even the ministry that you have done, were they acceptable to God? This question you have to seriously ask in yourself. If your brother has something against you, is this not what Jesus Christ says? And you are presenting your offering at the altar. And remember, he says, not that you despise, now you should understand, it is not that you despise your brother, but that brother has something against you. Verses 24, leave your offering there before the altar and go your way. First be reconciled to your brother and then come and present your offering. What he says here is, someone has an anger towards you because you have done something to them. This anger that person is holding against you, not because of your ministry of correction. While doing the ministry of correction, many people will be angry. That's why many people are angry at me. I cannot come and reconcile with you. You should understand that. Not that anger of people, that such kind of anger that Jesus refers. Jesus says, when we have to reconcile, always, because always we are praying. Always we are worshipping, those who are worshipping and praying. We must never imagine that God can accept an offering from us when we have enmity in our heart. Perhaps after reading this or after hearing this message, you may say that if I had anything against my brother, I would go to him at once and say, this is what many people will just, no, I don't have any anger towards anyone. Immediately I will clarify. Immediately I will ask God forgiveness. Not that that is what God is talking here. Okay, Jesus mean here, because of your ego and pride, somebody has got anger towards you. Here the situation is, someone has grievance against you. Someone has something against you because of your pride and your ego. This is what here Jesus Christ says. The other anger also you have to deal with. But here what Jesus Christ is telling, because of your ego, because of your pride, or because of your sin, somebody has got an anger towards you. Did you get me? Jesus is calling for the offender to take the initiative in this process. That is, even if we hold nothing against him, we might have forgiven, but that person is holding against you. If he is angry with or hates us, we should go. We should do everything in our power to be reconciled to him. We might have expected Jesus to focus primarily on the offended party, since they are the most likely to feel the anger towards another. Instead, in these verses, it is the offender who initiates the process of reconciliation. You need much humility in this action. Did you get me? You need a lot of humility to do this action. Otherwise, your prayers are not acceptable. Elsewhere, Jesus urges the offended party to make first move. Matthew 18:15. Jesus said, if your brother sins against you, go and tell him his fault between you and him alone. If he listened to you, you have gained your brother. Here, someone has sinned against you. Here also, you have to reconcile with that person. But our context, someone is holding anger against us. Both share an obligation to work for resolution. When there has been a conflict, ideally, two would meet on the way or to one another and settle the differences on the way. Too much of anger, no? Are you doing the Christian journey? You only think. You're stagnant. You're not doing the Christian journey. Having the anger at home and among the brothers and sisters. What is this church? You should think. You should understand how important it is to deal with enmity, disagreement, animosity, or anger. Reconciliation is so important that it takes priority over everything else. It takes precedence over worship and prayer. Before you pray, go and reconcile. So you will keep the anger, that's okay, God forgive me. No, you have to go to that person. Without having peace with each other, we will not see God. Hebrews 12:14 says, and we cannot build each other having the spirit of anger in us. My friend, please understand. Romans 14:19, having the spirit of anger inside, we cannot build each other. Anger at home or among the anywhere. Anger is anger. Obviously, we cannot change another person's heart or attitude, but our desire and effort should be to close the breach as much as possible from one side and hold no anger ourselves even in the other person, even if the other person does. True worship is not enhanced by better music, I always tell. You people want good music, the costliest music, costliest instrument, but you should understand the true worship is not enhanced by better music, better prayers, better architecture or better preaching. True worship is enhanced by better heart, the relationship between God and people. That's why people will tell God, you are good, but the people are not good. I have good relationship with God, but not with people. That cannot happen. Please understand. Here is another question. Are we responsible for all the grudges and the anger and enmity that people may feel against us? This question is especially for those who are in prominent positions like president, speaker, governor, or the even the host of a radio or TV show, or a preacher in a local church. Preacher in the local church has to get the anger from always from the people. So, but they don't have to come and counsel because people are offended because of the righteous word of God. In every one of these roles, the moment one opens his mouth, someone disagrees. Matthew 5, 10 to 12 says, blessed are those who have been persecuted for the sake of righteousness, not sin, but righteousness. For theirs is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you when men cast insult at you and persecute you and say all kinds of evil against you falsely, not truly, on account of me. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great, for so they persecuted the prophets who were before you. Jesus says here, sometimes people will hold something against you when they shouldn't be insulting you or persecuting you, saying all kinds of evil against you falsely, because you are standing for righteousness. That you should understand. But in your heart, anger should never deposit. So what do you do at such time? Do you stop worshipping? Because many people, you are telling the righteousness at home, in the church, wherever. So as you are standing for righteousness, many people will hate you. Many people will be angry at you. So what will you do? Can you go to everyone and reconcile? Do you need it? No, you don't need that. Okay, so you cannot be able to worship and pray? If so, Jesus could have never been able to pray and worship God, isn't it? He was constantly opposed by the people. People sought to trap him up in his speech. That's the reason. The slip of the tongue is enough. You will catch me. I know you. With what strength I have to come before the people, you know. They tried to kill Jesus Christ. They tried to shame him. Many hated him. Many were angry at him. Was he responsible for that? No, not at all. He said that the same would be true for the true disciples of him. Matthew 24:9. He said, you will be hated by all nations on account of my name. In other words, if you are faithful to Jesus Christ, if you are sincere to Jesus Christ, someday or somebody will always have something against you. People will accuse you if you are faithful to Jesus Christ. 1 Peter 4:14 says, if you are insulted for the name of Jesus Christ, you are blessed because the Spirit of glory rests upon you. So we are only responsible for what others hold against us when it is only to real sin, when our ego or pride might have offended them, not for correcting them. You should understand the difference. Paul says in Romans 12:18, if possible, as far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. So for us, it depends on you, Paul says. The lesson that the Lord Jesus Christ is teaching through these two illustrations is, if there is anything wrong in your spiritual life, put it right immediately. Don't waste time, because any hesitation is costly. Okay, as the spirit of murder grows in you, something is growing in you. As what the spirit of murder can bring you, the punishment it can bring you. Please understand, one day you will be bedridden just because of your anger. It is growing in you. You know, the strength of your anger in you. You know how much you can forgive the people. There is nothing like ending dispute at once before the bitterness grows and your adversary becomes determined to push you to the extreme. What we need is more of the spirit of yielding, more of humility. You know how people say, if you tread a worm, it will turn. Isn't it? If you tread a worm, it will turn. But we should understand, worm is not an example for a Christian. Christians should not live like a worm. A spiritual man acts quickly when it comes to getting right with the God. Wise virgin are quickly, immediate obedience, quick action, quick righteous action. That is the quality of the wise people, you should understand. So, spiritual man acts quickly when it comes to getting right with God. He is wise and have extra oil he carry just because of very this action of him. You should understand. And there is another principle that we need to notice here. Lord Jesus Christ says that our relationship with Lord Almighty directly connected with our relationship with one another. Please understand this fact. You cannot have grudge against the people and have a good relationship. Don't think that you can have a good relationship with God just because you have quiet time every day and you spend long period of time in prayer and worship, even in ministry. Matthew 5:25, Jesus Christ says, come to terms quickly with your accuser while you are going with him to court, lest your accuser hand over you to the judge and judge to the guard, and you will be put in prison. Jesus is using this illustration from secular life as a picture of sin against another person. He is telling that such sin, that is unpaid debt, must be resolved quickly to avoid having to face the sentence from the divine judge. We are to make every effort without delay to make our relationship right with our brothers and sisters, not just Christian brothers, but all the mankind in general. Jesus is teaching us that if someone holds a debt of any sort against us, as soon as see, Bible says, I think in Romans 13 it says, nothing other than love we should owe anyone. That is the debt we owe, not the grudge, you should understand. So with the anger, you are moving with Satan. Satan will hand over you to the judge and judge to the officer. Officer is God Almighty. Once you are reached to the officer, that is, God will give you time to repent, my friends, and turn to God. Within that time, if you are not repenting from the broken and a contrite heart, definitely you will be put into jail. Jail of problems, jail of sickness. There is no doubt. That's the meaning of Matthew 5:25. Proverbs 30:33 says, pressing milk produces curds, pressing nose produces blood, pressing anger produces strife. Jesus is calling for reconciliation to be sought early, aggressively and quickly, even if it involves self-sacrifice. People cannot come down from their ego, that's their problem. Your lack of readiness to reconcile is your ego and a cause for dishonoring God. At the same time, you are dishonoring God. Your ego and pride will dishonor God. How much ever you pray and think that your prayers are reaching heaven, no. With the spirit of anger, or the spirit of anger infects the soul, dying with that spirit of hatred still in your heart, you will never escape from the prison of hell, the prison of problems, the prison of sickness while you are alive in this earth. You see, the relationship with God is directly affected by our relationship with one another. Please understand, friends, if your relationship with your brothers and sisters is not right, you are wasting your time trying to get through God a prayer. A person cannot see. Don't pray, God is telling. When you have something against someone or somebody has got an anger, he's telling, don't pray, you are wasting your time. Don't worship, you are wasting your time. Don't do even ministry, you are wasting your time. First go, make peace with that person. Otherwise your prayers and worship and ministry is of no use, he says. A person cannot expect to be right with God if he is not right with his brother. And also a broken fellowship with another person means broken fellowship with God. You have broken with many people the relationship. But you have a good stand before God. Because I pray a lot, I worship a God, God's presence is there. I always tell, people don't believe me. I know now the hearts of the people. That's why I'm telling, this is of marriage. Marriage is an experience of intimacy, of commitment and of love. But marriage is not easy without love. Married life will become hard when there is hatred and anger between husband and wife. Understand, you are killing each other when you are fighting. When you cannot control your anger, understand, you are killing each other. That's the reason the marriages will break one day. Without having a good relationship with your family members, you cannot have a good relationship with your God. Your anger, hatred, bitterness, jealousy will break your relationship with God. Listen to what Peter says in 1 Peter 3:7. He says, behave in a considerate, please listen to me here, husbands and
wives,
those who are going to marry also. He says, behave in a considerate manner with your wife. That's why all are eager to marry. First, to correct your character, otherwise you are killing each other. Please understand, all are waiting. When you cross 20 only, you are waiting, dreaming for marriage. Dream to set right your character. Then only you should go for your marriage. Otherwise, your marriage is of no use. Please understand. Peter says, behave in a considerate manner with your wife, treating her with honor as a weaker one, so that your prayers may not be hindered. If your relationship with your wife is not right, your communication with God is hindered. Friends, you should understand, Colossians 3:19 says, it is a commandment for the husbands, do not be harsh with wife. Why? Bible is telling, because always husbands will have a superiority feeling above
wives.
So they think that they are liable, they think that. But you don't know what you are doing with your anger. And your pride will stop you to go and ask that wife forgiveness, isn't it? Please understand, many of you are here, I know personally. You will justify your anger and you will not go and make peace with your wife. Friend, please understand, whether you believe Jesus Christ or what, you are depositing the spirit of murder inside of you. One day, the heart disease will come in you. Please understand. You earn money. Now, no time. No. Run for your work. Earn money. Because of your anger, you have to go fast. And you have to earn money. Because something is developing in already something. Go and ask. Have a heart checkup. Something is already developing. Or by the mercy of God, God is not showing you. God is waiting upon you. So that you will deal with your anger. That is the reason. Colossians is a commandment for the husbands. Do not be harsh at wife. They are weaker vessel. You think you can see, not just because I'm a wife I'm talking, because I'm talking about your anger. What is going to give you anger, you should understand. And you, as you feel the superiority over the wife, you are holding the anger inside and you think you can justify your anger. But friend, understand, you are growing with the spirit of murder. One day, a heart disease will hit you. There is no doubt about that. Even if you go from me because the way I'm preaching is you don't like it, this will follow you. Please understand. At the same time, Bible is commanding wives. Wives should be yielding to husband. And Proverbs 21:19 says, it's better to live alone in a corner of the roof inside of the house than with a quarreling wife. That also wives should understand, okay? Without love, the marriage will not be built. Understand. Husband and wife will be holding anger towards. Your ego will not go to each other and ask, forgive me. But you don't know what you are growing inside. The same principle is implied here. A break with. So, the relationship with husband and wife, the same relationship with one another. A break with one another means a break with God. Stick and stones can break our bones, but words can hurt our heart, you should understand. Husbands and wife will use words in such a way. Not only I'm talking about husband and wife, children also. What word you will be using to parents or others, your word will hurt them. You don't know what you are doing. You, at the same time, you don't know what you are depositing in your heart. That's the reason Paul says in 1 Timothy 2:9. Therefore, I want the men means men and women, in every place to pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension. That is prayer. Did you get me? How much your prayers are wasted, isn't it? How much quiet time you have spent with God? Don't you think all these were waste? You couldn't deal with this much I am preaching? Still, how many of you are angry with me? That too, anger towards a leader is same as to God. It has got more power. That you should understand. That's the reason 2 Timothy 2:9, 2:8 Paul says, therefore I want men, men means men and men in every place pray, lifting up holy hands without wrath and dissension. The qualification for us to pray is to forsake ungodly anger. Okay, with that anger, go enjoy the world. That's better. Why you want to go and sit and pray? If we are angry, our fellowship with God is adversely affected. Next time you become angry at your spouse or children or family members or fellow believer, don't deceive yourself into thinking that it's no big deal. But you should understand it's a big deal. Have a humility to walk up to that person and ask, because of you, because of your anger, somebody has got anger. Maybe they might have forgiven you, but you deposited the anger in that person because of your wrong nature. You should understand. It is a big deal. Don't think that it's not a big deal. It's a big deal because being angry within your heart against someone is as strong as the sin of murder. Always think, when anger comes, understand you are killing someone. At the same time, you are killing yourself. Okay, so what should be our prayers? As James 1:19 says, we should pray that God give us, help us to hear fast and help us to be slow to answer and slow to anger. That should be our prayer. You should pray that prayer. We don't get anything from God unless we pray, isn't it? That's what James 4:4 says. You don't pray because you don't get it. From where this war is coming? Is it not from within you? You are fighting each other. Isn't it? Why you are fighting and have no control? Because you are not praying. So you should pray this prayer. God, I want to hear fast. But always I retaliate immediately. That should not happen. That should be our prayer. Let's close our eyes and pray.